Let's have a word of prayer, and then we're going to start our series here. God, thank you for this morning. God, I do cherish the church family you give us. As we're studying the Word, what it means to be a church member, as we're studying in Sunday school, the biblical basis, what you've called your church, Jesus gave his life for it. He looks at us in Ephesians and he says, she's beautiful. She's the bride I'm coming for. And he is anxiously waiting for you to tell him, go get your bride. God, that's us. Man, we're precious in your sight. This morning, Father, help me as the pastor to be true to your word. Help me to present it in love and care. And God, I pray that your Holy Spirit works in our lives. You hear me pray. Amen. I promised you a video. Here it is. That's good, right there. There we go. I don't want to play the second half. I'm saving it for another week, so I don't have to go find something else. Remember last week, we talked about this great, awesome cartoon. Parents, you can find it. It's not just for kids. It's great. But Isabel comes in at the beginning of every show. It kicks it off. What you doing? And as we talk about church membership, that's the question I'm asking all of us. What you doing? What you doing? This morning, I was wearing a different shirt. I have it on the front row if you want to see it, but I changed on purpose. Thank you for noticing, some of you. That means you really do care. Or you were jealous that I have a Royals jersey. One of the two was going on. But today we're talking about unity. We are following Tom Rainier's book, I Am a Church Member. He's got an outline to help us pastors teach through it. As deacons, we thought it would be a good study for us to understand as church members, as a church, what our roles are, to call us to a renewed relationship with Jesus Christ and each other as a church members. But sports, I love sports. I grew up playing them, any sport that I could play, I loved. I grew up playing baseball and soccer and basketball, and then into high school, I got into volleyball more, and even into college, I was able to play more volleyball. But I love sports, and right now, we're in baseball season. See the shirt? See how it works together? I can find ways to wear different clothes, but I will never find a sermon where a Speedo is appropriate for me to wear in shirt. Hey, see, I knew I'd at least get one amen this morning. Royals. Royals are my American League team. I grew up in Kansas City. I was at Kauffman when they had AstroTurf, and if it was 80 degrees outside, if you got lower seats, it was like 110 because that heat just radiated off there. I remember George Brett and Amos Otis. Those were my guys, and I remember following them as a kid. But I have an American League team, and the reason I have a National League team. The reason is we lived in Illinois for 7 years. And we were right in the middle of Chicago and St. Louis. And we needed to pick which team we were going to root for because I didn't get the Royals teams on Dish or Direct. I got the Cardinals or I got the Cubs. And so I had to decide between the Cubs or the Cardinals. Well, the Cubs are the Cubs. Okay? Is anyone a Cub fan in here? I'm sorry. There's still time to repent. Jesus hasn't come back yet. But the Cardinals, you know, they faced my Royals in the World Series, and they lost. So I'll root for the underdog, just not the Cubs. That's way under the underdog, okay? It's a rivalry between Cardinals and Cubs fans. Sorry, it's just the way it is. But the Cardinals were our National League team. And so, you know, I root for the Royals, and I root for the Cardinals. And right now, guess what teams are in first place in their divisions? The Royals have the best league, has the best record in the American League, and the Cardinals have the best record in the National League. It is good for me in sports right now. And then you add to that football starting. Now, in football, I have two teams as well. I grew up in Kansas City, so guess what? I'm a Chiefs fan. But in 85, I became a Bears fan. The Bears, remember that? They made that little video. And that's not why I'm a Bears fan. I am a Bears fan because they had this guy that would come in when they were in short goal situations, and he was big. This big-boned mountain of a man would come in, and they would hand him the ball, and he would blitz through and run over people and get in the end zone, and his name was William the Refrigerator Perry. And that's why I became a fan. I know you can't tell right now by looking at me, but I was called big-boned when I was a kid. I know, I just saw some of you nudge your big bone, the pastor's fat, and you're saying back to him, I know, but he doesn't know that. Bless his heart. So I followed the Bears. 6'2", 335 pounds of a defensive lineman would get in the backfield, and that funky QB named Jim McMahon would turn around and hand him the ball, and all he needed was a little crease in the line, and he would fit that huge figure of a guy, and he would bulldoze everybody and get in the end zone. I could relate. Everybody likes it when their team is on top. 65-44 with a 10.5 game lead in the American League Central, if you don't know the Royal stats. The Cardinals are 71-39 with a 6-game lead in their division, if you don't know their stats. Life is good right now as a sports fan. But you know, when they announce the leaders of these divisions, when I look at the stats, when I pull up the titles, I see the name Royals. I see the name Cardinals a whole lot more than I see Royals because the Cardinals have won more divisions. I was privileged to be able to watch them win two while we were in Illinois. They just win. But who gets the trophy? The team does. But you know, when I watch the game, and as the game starts, they give the team's record. But then, as that pitcher takes the mound, they also give another record, don't they? They give the pitcher's record. Or if you're watching hockey or soccer, they give the goalie's record. Why do they do that? Well, because for that day, the pitcher or the goalie is one of the most important people on the field. In football, they do the same thing for quarterbacks. Hey, this quarterback has such and such record against his team. Or in this division, since he changed teams, here's his record. Why do they do that? Because as leaders, as the guys who take the ball, as the guys who keep the puck or the ball from the net, they are seen as the leaders of that team, and they mark the success of the leaders. Now, those pitchers, none of their names are on those trophies. If you look at the Stanley Cup, it doesn't say all the names of the goalies. It has the team's name. It's about the team. There's individual parts, but it's about the team winning. It's about the team losing. What if in baseball they all decide they're going to take the field and everyone runs out to second base? I used to watch the Royals, remember? We played games like that years ago where it seemed like we had no one in the field. We couldn't even hit a ball. We weren't in the playoffs for eons. The Cubs even got back to the playoffs before the Royals. No, when they take the field, they know their positions. In football, it's even more important that there be unity because there's plays and there's calls. Basketball the same way. I need to know when to pick. I need to know when to be in this situation. There needs to be unity. There needs to be a plan to work from. Everyone needs to play their part, or we won't succeed. For a team to function properly, for a body to function properly, there needs to be unity. And when there's unity, teams win. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. And the reason I'm sitting down today is not that I'm tired, but I know if I walk around, you guys are going to be here for an hour today because I love talking about the church, and this passage is real rich, and I want to stick to what I've written. So that's why I'm trying to stay focused here. Ephesians 4, 1 through 3. Therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk worthy of the calling you have received with all humility and gentleness, with patience, accepting one another in love, diligently keeping the unity of the Spirit with the peace that binds us. The NFL, right now they are beginning the training camp. And right now if you watch ESPN or if you watch the things, they're all talking about the teams and those high draft picks, and they're talking about their record and their potential, right? This guy is going to have so many sacks. This guy is going to make an impact on the team. And what happens as the season starts and that player doesn't have that many receptions? That player doesn't run for that many yards. That player doesn't throw as many touchdowns, or he throws more interceptions. All of a sudden on the TV, you find analysts scrambling to try and find the reasons why they're not living up to their potential. And what we say is they're not living up to the hype, to the expectations this team has. And the analyst will say stuff like this. You know, well, I hear there's an injury, or I heard the guy's work ethic isn't very good, or I heard there is conflict with some of the players, or I heard that he has a disgruntled relationship, or he doesn't like the direction that the coach is heading. They understand that in that player, that in that team, everything is there for them to succeed. But something's broke. It's not happening. And the analysts are trying to find out why. Paul is telling the Ephesian church, I want you to live up to the hype. God has set the bar pretty high for the church. I didn't set the bar. I'm just the fortunate, or at times unfortunate, guy that has to tell us, hey, here's where the bar is. Keep on going. Keep on going. God has set the bar. And we know that we cannot live up to that level of expectation that God has set on our own. And God knows that we can't live up to the level of expectation He has set. So what God did is He came down in the form of Jesus Christ. And He lived among us. And He took all of these written words that we read in the Bible, and He lived it out. And He showed us how to live it out so that He can help us live up to the bar. God doesn't lower the bar. He helps us reach up and keep moving toward the goals that He sets. In John 13:25, in the New Living Translation, this familiar verse reads like this. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. John, the disciple who states in his book that Jesus loved him, and in his letters stresses the word love. John was that touchy-feely, emotional disciple, if you will. What he says is that the world is watching, and they will know if we are Christ, truly His, by the way that we interact with each other. There's a saying that I should have hanging up in my office, and I don't. I don't know where it went, but I have a bunch of sayings I always put in my office. What you call people with is what you call people to. What you call people with is what you call people to. There seems to be a lot of discussion today in our church and throughout history. What is the best church model to attract people? There is a wide spectrum, from little house churches to little coffee group studies to big church gatherings with almost rock star or country star performances. And God uses both ends of the spectrum. Neither one of them is wrong, unless you are not emphasizing and lifting up Jesus Christ. Neither is wrong. Unless you are just doing it to check off your list that I went to church this week, that I did something for God. If you are not emphasizing Jesus Christ, if you are not studying His Word and saying, this is what God says, if you hear more, here's my opinion, or here's what you ought to do, instead of God's Word says this, you're probably in a church or you're probably in a place that is a man-made, man-run organization. Jesus Christ has to be the center. Jesus Christ has to be the unifying of a true church that follows after Him. Paul emphasizes all throughout his writings that the church, that unity comes and is because only of Jesus Christ. And when disunity happens, it's because we have set aside the reason we meet and we have warped our churches into something we like, we want, or we enjoy. And when God takes away His Spirit, all of a sudden, churches begin to die. Jesus tells us in His Word something that we don't often understand. Jesus said in the Bible that He would divide families. Do you understand that? Let me share the verse with you. Luke chapter 12, verses 51 through 53. I'm in the English Standard Version on most of my verses. Do you think that I have come to give you peace on earth? No, I tell you, rather division. For from now on, in one house, there will be five divided, three against two and two against three. There will be divided father against son and son against father, mother against daughter and daughter against mother-in-law, against her daughter-in-law and her daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. I thought Jesus came to bring peace. I thought Jesus came to bring comfort. No, Jesus came to bring life. Jesus came to bring redemption. He came to seek and to save the lost. It wasn't Jesus' desire to divide families. That's the byproduct of our choices. That's the byproduct of living in a sinful world. Love calls for decision making. It calls for commitment. And what unifies us as a church can't be our feelings of love, because feelings change. What unifies or should unify as a church is our commitment to Jesus Christ and His Word. Then we change our lives to mirror or mimic His teachings. Anything other than that is not a work of Jesus. It's a man-made false feeling. So, Scott, you're talking about church unity, and yet you just said that Jesus came to divide. What's your point? Well, Tom Rainier talks also about other things that causes division in the church. And here's the first one. He says that gossip and negative talk will cause disunity in a church. James chapter 3, verses 6 through 12. And the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our Lord and Father, and with it we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessings and curses. My brother, these things ought not to be so. Does a spring bring forth from the same opening both fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, bear olives, and a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a salt pond yield fresh water. What he is saying is our tongue is an uncontrollable thing, because our tongue is just the spigot that lets loose what's really inside our heart. See, what we have is a heart condition. Gossip and unrighteous talk, negative talk, comes out of a heart condition. But what is gossip? Well, I went to Merriam-Webster's, and here's what he defined gossip: a person who habitually reveals personal or sensational facts about others. A rumor or report of an intimate nature. A chatty talk. Now, this is the definition of our word gossip. Can you see in that definition talk that is aimed and directed toward tearing down people and dividing people? Sharing intimate thoughts that shouldn't be shared. Rumors, sensational facts. Chatty talk. Well, I've got to fear the air with something. So let's talk about this. But just like in our world today, we like to change the definition of meanings of words to fit our meaning. by the way that I have heard gossip defined, that being, and this is how I've heard it defined, you're just talking about someone behind their back. That's why I didn't ask for you guys to define gossip, because many of you would have given me that definition. That's not what gossip means. You can talk about someone behind their back. By the definition of the word gossip, I, as your pastor, have gossiped about almost every one of you in this room. You know that? Do you want? Let me explain myself before you go off the deep end. It's even on tape. Pastor gossiped about me. I'm never going back. Let me explain. When I came to Keys Baptist Church, I did not know you guys, and you did not know me. The best way for me to get to know you is to talk to people who know you, not to find out the dirt that I can pull out of the rug and say, look at all the dirt. No, I wanted to know you. Sometimes I would see you do something or react in a way, and I'm like, wait a minute, that doesn't look right. Is there something else going on? So I would ask someone, hey, what's going on with that person? Well, Pastor, why didn't you just come to me? Because if I would have come to you without you knowing me in a relational manner, you would have accepted that as, I'm just picking on you. See, it takes time to develop relationships. Whenever you fell in love with that special someone, did you just walk up to them and say, I love you, let's get married? No, you took time to learn about them. I took time to learn about Deanna, about her family, about her history. And it wasn't always from Deanna. It was from her friends at school. Hey, what does Deanna like? What does she not like? I wasn't gossiping about Deanna. I was trying to learn about her so I could love and serve her better. By the way, husbands, you need to keep learning about your wife, because God formed these creatures in such a way that they keep evolving. Amen. See, there we go. Ladies, keep learning about your husband. Not because we change, but because you're so busy taking care of our kids and doing everything else, you forget about us sometimes. It's not gossip to talk about people. Because you see, our tongues can be used for good. 1 Peter 3, verse 10. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Do you catch that last word? Deceit. See, gossip comes in when our intent is to tear down or to demolish or to cause pain. Deceit. I'm trying to deceive you. Half a truth is a whole lie. Do you hear that? When you tell stories, we talked about that this morning in Sunday school. You can take words out of context. You can take Bible verses out of context, and then all of a sudden you get inflamed because you don't know the backstory. You don't know what's going on. And you can build your whole life on falsities. I have ruined relationships in my life with people because of partial stories that either I heard or I didn't hear the whole conversation, and I went off the deep end. I'm thankful my wife still hasn't divorced me about it. But it's not just my wife. It's friends. It's church members. We need to speak truth, the whole truth. And we need to make sure that we're representing the whole truth the best we can. We don't want to be misleading with our speech. We want to be uplifting. Gossip and unwholesome talk can destroy unity. There's a second thing that Tom Rainier says that will destroy unity. A lack of forgiveness will destroy unity. Matthew chapter 6, verses 14 through 15. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Listen to me very carefully. Some of you are walking around carrying burdens and living in bondage, not because of what you've done or what you're doing. I should have said, we are walking around in bondage because of what, not because of what we've done or what we're doing. We are walking around in bondage because we are not forgiving. And God told us in His Word, if you don't forgive others, I'm going to withhold my forgiveness for you. No, God can't do that. He's a forgiving God. I've heard pastors say all we have to do is ask Him to forgive. Yes. But then He tells us, if you mean business, you better forgive others. And looking for a video. Well, I'm getting ahead of myself. That's why I'm trying to read. Unity will not happen if we don't forgive. Church unity will not happen if we don't practice and live forgiveness. Colossians 3, verses 12 through 13. Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, patience. If you're going to be a forgiving person, you've got to swallow your pride and you've got to get meek. That means you come with your hat in your hand, on your knees, asking for forgiveness sometimes. Bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so also you must forgive. Church, we cannot expect or ask God to move in our midst and for Him to do a mighty work through us and in us if we don't forgive others. In looking for video illustrations for my message, I came across a video illustration about forgiveness. I don't know how I did it, because I typed into Sermon Spice unity. And as I scrolled through all the videos, this one came up on forgiveness. And I clicked it. And it was simple, nothing fancy, just signs with words coming up. And it said, do you know or do you understand if you've forgiven someone? And it said, all you need to do is answer one simple question. Do you still talk about it? Pastor, I don't know if I've forgiven them. Do you still talk about it? I thought that was a very good answer. You have to let it go. You have to not bring it up. I can speak from personal experience. When I have asked for forgiveness and someone has given me forgiveness, I don't ever want to discuss that problem or anything remote with that person ever again, because I am so embarrassed and I am so humiliated that I hurt them. I hope we never even talk about it again. So if you're still thinking about it as an individual and you can't let it go, you probably haven't forgiven them yet. Our world seems to tell us that unity is about getting along. That to truly have unity, we need to go and we need to do what everyone else has done. Everyone else does, right? We have churches across our nation. Just, it splatters my Google homepage, my Yahoo homepage, my Facebook. Churches accepting gay marriage. Churches accepting this. Well, just because all these other churches are doing it, we ought to do it, right? Because we need to be unified as a church. Wrong. The church shouldn't be seen that way. Jesus came to be a disruption in a world full of sin. Did you hear what I just said? Jesus came to be a disruption. When everyone was going this way, taking their lives to hell, Jesus came and said, stop! I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to heaven except through me, and that's why I'm here. And He calls His church to do the same thing. We are called to unity under the banner of Jesus Christ. Not under the banner of Southern Baptist. Not under the banner of Catholic. Not under the banner of even Pentecostal or Methodist. Or even under the banner of Billy Graham. Or Greg Goschel or any other big guys. We are under the banner of Jesus Christ. Jesus came to disrupt this world. He came to break the bondage of addiction. He came to break the bondage of selfishness that tears down relationships. Jesus wants to heal and restore and set things right. But we won't see that here on earth, at least on a wide scale. You see, Israel was supposed to show the world what God can do. They were supposed to show the world what prosperity and blessing and care and submission to God was like. And they failed. And when they failed, God said, I still love you. I still need to provide for your sin. So God sent Jesus, and Jesus established the church. And we are supposed to show the world in today's day and age what Jesus is all about. But churches are dying and closing every week. Statistics have been proven time and time again that 80% of our churches are on decline. Why? Is Jesus dead? I hope not. They made a movie about it and it said he's not dead. No. His power is still there. He's still wanting to change the world. Is the mission complete? No, the mission isn't complete. We studied it this morning. God is willing that none should perish. No. As the worldwide body of Christ, we are failing because we are failing to remember who we are, whose we are, and what we're to be about. Unity doesn't just happen. Sports teams train individually to build their bodies as members of this team. And then they train together as teammates to hone their skills. Then they come together in training camps and practices to develop as a team. They develop their relationships and they become unified. Why? Because their coach tells them they have to? Because the book says you have to have unity? No, they become unified as athletes because they all want the same thing. They want to be champions. They want to be champions. How many times have you listened to a football broadcast or a baseball broadcast or a hockey broadcast? And they talk about how that guy on that team, no one likes him unless he's a teammate of yours. Why? Because he does his job so thoroughly, so impactfully, that other teams fear him. I know Pete Rose is a terrible guy, and I don't want him to ever lead a church I'm in. But if I'm playing baseball, I want Pete Rose. I loved watching Pete Rose when I was a kid, because that dude, even in an all-star game, laid it all on the line. So, the question is, what you doing? I can't answer that for you. What you doing? Why are you in church? Why are you a member of a church? Are you here to change the world, to change your country, to change our state, to change our cities? Jesus said he would do that. And he wants us to be a part of that. But it calls for unity. And unity is built around submission to God and to his word. And it's built around love. Love that we don't express in and of ourselves that comes from a transformed life. We have to keep him first. Submit to his teachings and directions. And learn what it is to truly love as he loves. And he gave us the church for us to learn to do that. I hope this year, as a sports fan, one of my favorite teams holds the championship trophy. I would love to say I hope all of them are, but since I have teams in separate divisions in the same league, I can't do that. But I hope the Royals or Cardinals raise that World Series trophy. I hope the Bears or the Chiefs are Super Bowl champs. But more importantly to me this year, I hope that Keys Baptist Church is a church that truly reflects Jesus, and that our community knows that if they need to find Jesus, it'll be here at Keys Baptist Church because of the way they see us live our lives and how we treat each other. And if we ever, by some natural disaster, had to close our doors as Keys Baptist Church, they would lament the fact that we're not here anymore because we loved them so intensely, so amazingly, that they knew that the presence and the Spirit of Jesus Christ was here. That takes unity. In our bulletin, it has the pledge for the week underneath the prayer request, just like last week. Every week he has a pledge for us to consider. It says, I am a church member. I will seek to be a source of unity in my church. I know there are no perfect pastors, amen, staff, or other church members, but neither am I. I will not be a source of gossip or dissension. One of the greatest contributions I can make is to do all I can in God's power to help keep the church in unity for the sake of the gospel. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, this morning as we continue through a series about the church, I'm an imperfect man talking about a perfect God and trying to help as the local under-shepherd, pastor, and lead imperfectly a bunch of other imperfect people. And the burden of the mission to reflect a perfect God and a perfect love is one that we can't do without you in our midst. And as we've studied this morning, unity doesn't always mean that everyone's in agreement and that we're all always moving in the right direction. But the unity you want for your church is that we are promoting and exhorting Jesus Christ, that we are following what you told us to do before you went back to heaven, and we're not just putting people through the water, but we are living life together and we're becoming mature followers of Jesus Christ, that we are making disciples. And that takes commitment. That takes reflecting a love that the world cannot find outside of a relationship with you. This morning, we give you our tongues. When we're tempted to talk bad about our church or say, I wish it wasn't this way or things would change, I pray that you would put a lock, that you would put a cough in our throats to make us rethink what we're about to say. Because the world does not live in our church. The only reason our community knows how bad or what's going on in the church is because we as members leave and talk. God, we need to not gossip. We need to uplift your body of Christ. Father, forgiveness. One thing that keeps us from enjoying fellowship is that we've been hurt and we don't want to let it go. God, help us to forgive, not just for that other person's sakes, but because you tell us that you are not going to be forgiving us if we're not letting that stuff go. It's our prayer that Keys Baptist Church be a shining light in a dark world. Move our hearts. Help us to not just say we did it, not just to be vocal with our words, but help us to change our lives to align with your word. Period. Help us to get rid of the schemes of man. Help us to get rid of human reasoning and to focus back on your word. You promised you would bless that. This morning, as we get ready to close, as everyone has their heads bowed, including me, you can check if you want. I'm not looking up. I don't know where you are as an individual. Only God does. But I am burdened this morning because I know, because I've done it, that I've held on to things that I should have given over to God. And I'm here to tell you this morning, it doesn't always involve you going to that person and saying, I'm sorry, I've been holding a grudge, because oftentimes they don't even know that you're holding a grudge. But what it does take is for you to say, God, this is yours. Help me not to think negatively about that person. Forgiveness can keep a movement of God from flourishing maybe we all need to admit that we need a bigger lock on our tongues. Father, this morning, we need you. We don't need any more good words. We need you to fill our hearts. We need you to give us the power to get rid of the sin and the things that we're holding on to because they're comfortable to us, so that we truly can see a mighty work of you. Help us to not lower the bar. Help us to not make excuses, to give reasons why we can't be what you've called us to be. Help us to encourage one another, to spur on one another, to reach high for that bar.